Sad to make a trip like that and get to play, two or three plays in a game. And it happens so fast, you're always looking for a replay. This is a great catch by Aaron Bachter on the next play. We had a first and 25 after that, and he makes a great play. The thing is, he gets hurt and he's out of the game. So we go two plays, lose our top two tailbacks. We come here and Paul Cech makes a throw to Chris Crutchfield for the touchdown. So, you know, our offense overcame a lot of things on this drive and still came out with the touchdown.
How bad did that hurt you, losing Vactor and Henderson? I mean, looking back on it.
Well, I'll tell you right now, you know, I think there's still quite a drop-off between Ron Henderson and the rest of our tailbacks. And then the thing is, during the week, you can only get so many people repetitions.
Yeah.
And so now you're playing with, Abel and Dion, who are good running backs, but have gotten limited reps this year just because they've been running third and fourth on it. So I think you lose a little bit of your continuity.
And some intensity, too, because the kids look at that thing that happened to Henderson that I'll talk more about it, but I don't want to, you know, criticize the officials any more than I have. And this, I'm sure it disheartened him, too, to see Henderson go out of the game. Anyway, you guys kick off.
Here's a nice deep kickoff, and Mark Ringsdorf, again, strong safety for us, makes a tackle on this. And Mark's been playing very, very well on our specialty teams.
This play was successful for him a lot of the time, that little quick opener off the
right. And again, we slant the line, and a little bit of it's understanding what our line's doing up front, and our linebackers got to make sure they fill. This is a third down play here. They run a little slant pattern broken up there by Mark Mattingly and Rodney Bradley.
Pretty good pass defense all day for you.
Right, really pretty good overall. They had a punt again. We get the ball, run a little trap play here to Roy Napora again from it. The offense is doing some things. I was happy they kept North Dakota State off it. We get a first down here on a pass from Paul Cech to Chris Crutchfield. In a game like this against North Dakota State, which was a big example, like last year when we did beat them, is the fact that your offense has got to keep the ball and keep them off the field. We punt here, get pretty good coverage. It's Alex McCoy and Jennings down there on that particular play. Now here's a big play. They fumble.
Yeah.
We bounce it around, bounce it right into their tight end's hands. He runs 40 yards downfield before we're able to tackle him. It's a big field position play, and once they get the ball, you know, inside the 30-yard line, they're in four-down territory, and that's very tough to handle them. They run this little toss sweep a couple times, and again, it's not a play that's very successful against us. It's one of those plays you sort of wonder why they put it in, because they run the option so well. This is Sim Dorn, their quarterback out there, just a great athlete, and we had the option, played pretty well there, and he put a move on the person that's responsible for him, and he goes into scoring, and he is good, and probably one of the top ball players in Division II football.
So you play him even the first quarter, it winds up 7-7. Paul Cech back to pass as we pick up action once again. I got a feeling that fumble play and the loss of Henderson in the early in the game like that was a big, big momentum swing play.
Yes, it was. You know, we made a pass there to Crutchfield. Here's Paul Cech throwing to Paul Ballmer.
Nice catch.
Both of them from Skyler there. And we get another first down. And, I was happy with the fact that after they score, we come back and we move the ball a little bit. We ended up punting. They throw a ball here to Craig Guerin from Grand Island, Nebraska there. Guerin went up there as a QB. He's turned into an excellent receiver for him. Again, they run that little cutback dive up inside, and we're not real disciplined in making the play in there. And they run hard, and they've got some good running backs. Here's Paul Storbeck making a great play on Simborn. But key on that was, again, on the outside, we were in the position, made him slow down a little bit. They run the outside veer right here, and it's something that they haven't run a lot in the past against us. Matter of fact, I don't think they've run it for the last 5 or 6 years.
So surprised you've been.
Well, we showed it to our kids, but sometimes you don't make the correct reactions, and I think we're very much quarterback conscious in this game also. Here's another play, that you've got to avoid against these guys. We have a quick slant pattern called right here, and it was covered, and we end up taking the loss, but we come right back here and run another good pattern and make the catch, at least get some room so we can punt the ball without being in our end zone. But the score, is 14-7 at that point right then. comes
they get
up.
Good field position again,
right.
too.
This
that.
Is Craig Sikora. Came in again. Rick Rowe got hurt, I think, on the second series of the game. And Craig Sikora came in and did a nice job playing for us. They get down there in the goal line. They ran unbalanced. They do a good job of using formations to create some confusion as far as who's responsible for dive pitch and so on. This was an extra point attempt. We ended up recovering. We told our kids, well, if that happens, we got to start throwing the ball around because you're not going to lose anything. You might end up getting 2 points. So we're down 20-7 right now. Again, you know, I thought we've done some fairly good things. We haven't turned the ball over on this. We end up getting a first down right here.
Nice to see our bell running again.
Yes, yes it is. Again, I think right now, we might have got a little bit anxious to move the ball down the field. I think, at 20-7, it's maybe a time to get in and regroup. We end up punting right there. Their guy muffs the ball right to us, and the official, we get called for not giving him enough room to catch the ball. And
well, maybe you shouldn't run down the field.
Right. I guess, it's one of those that I don't know if the Bison need quite that much help on this. But they come out throwing the ball, and I guess this is probably one of the series that really disappoints me. They throw the ball in there to Guerin. We don't make the tackle, and we let them score. And there's a big difference, going in at halftime. They run a two-point conversion. So now we're down 28-7 at half rather than 20-7.
So you go to the locker room trailing by 3 touchdowns after scoring first against the number one ranked team in the nation. Is that momentum you got from that first score, was that lost a lot on that long fumble return, that lucky fumble return that they got?
I think you lose some of it on that. And then the fact that they're a very intimidating team. And, I thought their defense, as the game went along, they pinned their ears back. They started getting after us. And, we have a tendency sometimes to let ourselves get intimidated and moved out of our game plan. But the bad part about it, I think, is when it's 28-7, now you no longer can really think about running the ball type of thing. You got to throw it. And you might have a series where you have 3 incompletions. That's how much time off the clock. And that's the key against teams like this, is you've got to control the ball, you've got to move the chains, you got to keep the ball away from them. If our defense is on the sidelines, we're a much better defense.
Let's take a look at the second half highlights now. It's 28-7, North Dakota State on top of UNO. And let's go back to Fargo for those second half highlights. Marino's going to kick off once again to the 7-yard line, and no return on this. Good coverage by the UNO Mavericks.
See, this one might have been the best bounce we've had all year, on this one. But again, Tony is doing a much better job of kicking the ball. They come right back out again, and they run that little dive play inside. And not only does he make a run, we miss a tackle and we get a late hit from it. But those are calls. I'm sure it was there, but also I noticed they had a lot of people helping with the call. But kids stick right in there. Chris Bandner makes a play there on this, and they suck it up. We let them out of the hole down there, and again, this is Simdorn, the quarterback running. Just an excellent person, makes the right calls out there. And, they do a great job of running their offense. But we do hold them right here. They have to try a field goal, which is no good. So, the kids are you overuse the term sometimes. We're playing hard. Sometimes we're not playing very disciplined defense out there. But it's not for lack of effort.
They get the ball back again after UNO can't move it. Nice play there.
Right.
Corner.
That's Kerry Newman. Again, they have to punt, or they missed a field goal, and they have to come back and punt the first two drives of the second half. So I thought our kids did a little bit better assignment-wise defensively and so on. But, we've got to get to a point. This is a real key one right here. We held them. They call our nose guard for holding on the punt return, which...
So they get the ball back.
They get it back, and they end up going in for the score. They're not the kind of team that you can allow them to get the ball back on those types of plays. I don't think they need quite that much help in doing some of these things.
A kick for the extra point. Score goes to 35-7. North Dakota State on top. And then another kind of breakdown. I guess if things start going bad, they continue to go bad. That's one of Weber's laws.
Right. you could travel right along with us this year, and we could put in some of the top ones there from it. Again, you can tell inside. You know, they're playing hard. Roy Napor is going. I mean, it's a great effort by Roy there. He happens to lose the ball. They recover it in good field position down there.
I guess laying on top of somebody else, you're not really down then, huh?
Right, right. But again,
good defense.
You know, we got good defense, and we hold them right down here on this particular series. And that's Kirk Coleman there forcing the pitch, and Corey Barr making
nice
the
hit
tackle.
By Barr, yeah. Now another weird play coming up as soon as you get the ball back. Here's an incompletion.
Right, nice play there by Mark Mattingly, and maybe they're a little bit before the ball, but still a nice aggressive play.
So you get the ball back now, and watch this. Watch where he is when he throws the ball.
Right.
He throws it before he gets to the end zone, but they call that intentional grounding and a safety.
Right, and the ruling was that he was in the end zone when he threw the ball from it, so they get 2 points. And again, that's their judgment calls. You know, and I guess like everybody else, some days it's not the greatest judgment days for it, and obviously we don't need those types of things. Been nice if we'd have picked the blitz up and we wouldn't have been in that situation in the first place.
Maybe this is the judgment day that everybody says has been coming for such a long time.
I tell you, we end up here kicking after the safety, and they're always nice. They do bluff the ball, but it does bounce right back.
Oh,
up.
Sure.
But we have some good coverage, and again by Dan Sellin down there. They're running here, the option again. Rich Luter again runs down the quarterback on the outside. And again, I think the last three or four ball games, Rich Luter's played like an all-conference football player that he can be. And there's a nice play by Paul Storbeck. And again, as I mentioned, I think our tackles played excellent ball games.
Luter and Storbeck being great ball players for him.
Another nice play there by Mark Priest on the pass.
It's a happy fan all bundled up.
Right. They get used to it up there, and they insulate themselves pretty well inside and out, I think.
More good punt coverage.
Right. We punted the ball fairly well, and Jeff Jennings in on the tackle on that particular one.
So the end of the third quarter.
Right. And they've scored 9 points in the third quarter, and I thought they had some excellent field position. The kids sort of sucked it up and made some plays. They come in now with a freshman QB, Beachy, who will be sort of the heir apparent. Excellent athlete. I think he's decathlon champ in the North Central Conference. Comes out here on a bootleg. We get good pressure, and again, another play, a good play by Mark Mattingly on that. And so the kids, are still, flying around, making some plays. This is Deion Martin on a lead draw play there. And I think our tailbacks did a good job. A lot of it, not getting a lot of reps during the week. They run this toss sweep. Paul Storbeck kicks it outside. Mark Mattingly makes a play on that.
Bulldogs him down. Nice play by Mattingly. Beachy up the middle to the 22, Holman on the tackle here.
This is the one, too, we couldn't understand. I think the guys stop. If you notice, their whole team starts to push. The whistle hasn't blown yet. And now the play's dead. I don't know, somebody's going to get hurt probably in some of those situations. They run the ball up inside on this. Corey Barr makes a hit, forces the fumble, and I think Rodney Bradley recovers it. Here's Kirk Coleman on a blitz, throws Carlson for a
loss. This is on the next series. Yeah, Carlson sacked. And then an incomplete pass broken up by Priest. Oh, almost had it.
Well, I tell you what, it was broken up. I think what he broke up was the interception right there. We always tell him there's a difference between passes broken up and interceptions dropped. This is Paul Storbeck making a nice play out here. Help from Craig Sikora. And, they get after him, a fumble, and Mark Mattingly comes in and recovers the fumble.
Fernandez up the middle.
Right, this is Abel Fernandez running here late in the game.
Is he finally completely healthy?
I think he is. The problem that he got into is, with that hamstring early, I think it was about 4 weeks before he was ready to play, and he just hasn't gotten very many reps. We usually do some hitting with people on Mondays, and he's not there on that night either. They score late in the game, and we put some young kids into play, and I with the idea is that they've got to understand that the intensity level that they have to play with against the number one team.
That last shot reminds me. I was shooting a game a couple of weeks ago. 44-7 is the final score. I was shooting a game a couple of weeks ago, and I took the option guy and I followed him all the way to the end zone, the 5-yard line. He threw his hands up in the air. And I said, this guy didn't even have the ball, and I'm following him all the way down the field. Okay, let's look at the final stats. 26 first downs to 8, but that 443 yards rushing, you know, I mean, they're the number one team in the nation.
I tell you, they're a very dominant team, and obviously they dominated us on that day. We can't let them have, you know, that many rushes, you know, that many yards down there in scoring territory. And so, I mean, yeah, it was a game where they went out and did exactly what they wanted to do, you know, for the most part. And I guess the thing is that from the standpoint that, you know, we have got to be able to, you know, shut some people down down there. And I think we did at times do a pretty good job, but we just got to be able to keep our defense off the field.
Yeah, they get tired. More stats to take a look at.
You know, time of possession was, if you watch the game, it was probably about what you figure. It was about 15 minutes, 14 minutes, something like that. Difference in time of possessions from it. And again, that's something that you've got to stay away from. I think last year when we beat them, they had the ball for 23 or 24 minutes.
Looking around the league, Morningside beats Augie and South Dakota edges St. Cloud State. Noel's not happy, I'll bet you.
No, and I'll tell you, South Dakota is a team that's continued to get better during the year, because when we played them, I didn't think they were, you know, obviously a very good team.
Here's an interesting score. You got to play South Dakota State next weekend, and they barely lost to Northern Colorado.
I tell you, they should have won it. The last play of the game, they caught a ball in the end zone, and the official ruled that he was out of the end zone, which he was in this case. But they've always been a very good, I think, solid offensive football team, and they're getting people that were banged up a little bit early in the year back, and they never seem to have any problem scoring points or moving the ball. And if they happen to be playing good defense on that day, you're usually in for a tough ball game.
The standings, this will be the championship for the league, this game coming up. North Dakota State and North Dakota, they stand 1-2, a full two games ahead of Northern Colorado, and then everybody else kind of falls in the middle there.
Right, and you know, I think the ones that, you know, for whatever reason, Mankato and Augie are having little problems being real consistent. Morningside's gotten back on track and won a couple games. St. Cloud is, you know, had some injuries and they're down there. South Dakota, like I said, I think they're getting better as the year goes on. And in South Dakota State and UNO, they're at the bottom with our big battle coming up this week from it. And basically, about the way we're playing right now is where we're at in the standings. You know, we're not playing well enough to be up there with the other ones.
You talked about Rich Luter and what a great game, what a great season he's had all year long. Paul Storbeck and Luter had real fine games for you. And Luter was featured as your defensive player of the week this week.
Right. You know, and I think Rich, one of the things about it is, you know, we played a couple pretty good teams the last weeks, and I think when you're a good ball player of the caliber that Rich Luter can be, you enjoy playing against good football teams. And it seems like he usually has a pretty good game against a North Dakota State. He's able to use his speed and to make plays. And you really, really notice him out there from it. But, he, you know, he's playing the way that he's capable of playing.
On offense, you got Chris Crutchfield, caught the touchdown pass, made some nice receptions for you.
Well, I think the thing about me is, you know, Chris worked very hard in practice last week. And, you know, there's a lot of things that he's got to learn about reading coverages and things like this. But he's the kind of person that if you'll get out there and coach him, he'll try very, very hard on it. So I was glad to see that he had some success in this game. And, you know, hopefully it'll carry on to this last game against South Dakota State, and it'll carry on to next year.
Injuries, big injuries this past week?
Well, just Rick Rowe is the main one. And then since the game, Andy Bruckner got hurt in practice last night, also with a knee injury. So we got a couple more kids that have been playing quite a bit for us that'll miss the last game of the year.
The game's going to be an early kickoff for you this week.
Right, 1 o'clock on Saturday.
The Mavericks will play at home this coming weekend, as we said, 1 o'clock start, after their second week in a row traveling on the two longest road trips of the season. In this week's feature, we're going to see the Mavericks on the road on their trip to Northern Colorado.
The road trip to Greeley, Colorado for the Northern Colorado game started on a Thursday morning. Coach Bill McAllister makes travel plans for the team.
It's actually only on the bus for 4 hours today. It'll be on the bus probably about the same tomorrow. So I don't think, you know, if you're going to be on a bus, it's no different than what we're used to if we go to St. Cloud or North Dakota State. You know, it's the same amount of time, only we spread it out a little bit and hopefully let them relax a little bit more when we get there in the evenings.
Traveling requires careful budgeting of both time and money.
With the cost of flying right now to our travel party of 70, is often expensive. We like to think of our student, our athletes, as just being other students, and we encourage them to go to class all the time. And I think if they have accompanied our rule of, by going to class, you know, if they have tests or something, they make everything up, like to try to make them up before we leave.
So I'll miss two classes tomorrow, and that's it. I didn't miss any today. Coach Mueller gave us a note to take around and to dismiss us, and that if we had any homework that needed to be taken care of by the time we left, to turn it in Thursday morning, and that's what we did.
Road trips can allow players new experiences. The Colorado trip included a practice at the Denver Broncos practice field.
From what I know, it's a rather new facility, and it's kind of pumps you up a little bit to know that the pros practice on the field, and you know, you see, we saw John Elway and stuff. It's pretty neat.
As I never seen the mountains before, and now as we're coming up to here, I suddenly seen the mountains.
It's long.
It's not bad though. Coach split up in 2 days. It's all right.
A smooth trip requires a lot of planning.
It always worries me if other people are going to hold to the agreements that we've set up, food being delivered just on time, you know, or if we're going to arrive on time. Some places the food is on time and maybe we're late. But when you're traveling 8 hours on a bus, you know, you just got to set up the meals and stuff as close as possible. Sometimes you have cold food. Sometimes it's not ready yet. Sometimes it's because you're early, and sometimes it's because you're late.
And what to do during those long hours on the bus?
The videos definitely help with the video buses, you know, watching movies. I know as coaches, we do a lot of planning. It's kind of like another day in the office for us. It's just not very, the lap isn't as conducive as a desk is.
Well, I study a lot. I do study some, and we play cards. Play cards for fun, we watch a lot of movies.
Sounds like a typical work day for me, watching movies and playing cards at work and stuff. I got to go on one of those road trips. That's more fun than working.
I'll tell you, this one I think was a tough one for Bill to plan out because of the 2 days, but yeah. Everything went pretty smooth, and I think it was an enjoyable time out there, other than not beating Northern Colorado. But
talk a little bit about South Dakota State. You said they're starting to get people healthy. That seems like it happens every week, people that have been out get healthy, particularly for UNO. South Dakota State's got, like you said, a tough offense, and if they're playing defense, they're a good ball club.
I tell you, they've been traditionally very tough on UNO from it, and over the years, they've had great quarterbacks up there, and there's no lack of quarterback ability up there right now. This Bowman kid's a very good athlete, and defensively, they're very aggressive. The last couple of years, I think they've been playing the best defense they've had for quite a while. But, they're playing pretty good ball right now, and I don't think their record, their 2 wins are over South Dakota, I think, on that. So, but they're not a bad team. They should have beaten Northern Colorado.
Let's keep it that way, that the only 2 wins they have in the season are over the same team. Early start, 1 o'clock kickoff. You don't want to go into November with night games, do you?
I don't think so, personally. I've been out too many nights now from it, and we're hoping to have some nice weather there Saturday afternoon.
Coach, best of luck for your final game of the regular season, and we'll see you next week for the highlight show, hopefully with a victory, huh?
Yeah, thank you.
All right, and we'll see you too. Thanks for being with us. For Tom Mueller, this is Dave Weber saying, join us again next week for Maverick Football 1990.
Maverick Football 90 is provided in part